Sometimes referred to as Joe Bananas, Joseph Bonanno took control of Salvatore Maranzano's crime family after the Castellammarese War, which he ran from 1931 to 1968. Allegedly, in 1963, Bonanno made plans with Joseph Magliocco, who was denied a seat on the commission previously, to assassinate several rivals on the Mafia Commission. However, their foiled attempt would force Magliocco into retirement, and Bonanno would flee to Canada. It is known that Joseph Bonanno, at the age of 26, became one of the youngest ever bosses of a crime family. Joseph Bonanno was born on January 18, 1905, in Castellammare del Golfo, Sicily, to Salvatore Bonanno and Catherine Bonventure. Although the Bonannos left Sicily for the United States when Joe Bonanno was a child, they only stayed in Brooklyn for about 10 years before returning to Italy. Bonanno was first introduced to the Mafia in Sicily, and according to Selwyn Robb's Five Families, Benito Mussolini's crackdown on organized crime prompted Bonanno to return to America without a visa in 1924. Bonanno re-entered the country in 1924, stowing away with Peter Mybedino on a Cuban fishing boat bound for Tampa, Florida. He later began engaging in bootlegging activities, during which he co-owned a distillery in the basement of an apartment building with Gaspar Di Gregorio and Giovanni Romano, who was killed in the distillery by an accidental explosion. During this time, Bonanno's boss, Salvatore Maranzano, became his mentor. During the Castellammarese War, which lasted from 1930 to 1931, Maranzano and Bonanno fought against a rival group led by Joe Masseria and Giuseppe Morello in Brooklyn. However, a third, secret faction of younger mafiosi on both sides soon emerged. These younger mafiosi despised the old-world preferences of Masseria, Maranzano, and other old-line mafiosi, dubbed Mustache Pete's. Lucky Luciano, Masseria's second-in-command, led this group of young Turk mafiosi, which included Frank Costello, Vito Genovese, Joe Adonis, Carlo Gambino, and Albert Anastasia on the Masseria side, and Joe Profaci, Tommy Gaiano, Tommy Lucchese, Joseph Magliocco, and Stefano Magadino on the Maranzano side. Despite being more steeped in the old-school traditions of honor, tradition, respect, and dignity than other mafiosi of his generation, Bonanno saw the need to modernize and joined forces with the Young Turks. Luciano agreed to engineer the death of his boss, Masseria, in exchange for receiving Masseria's rackets and becoming Maranzano's second-in-command. He was killed on April 15, 1931. However, despite the fact that Maranzano was slightly more forward-thinking than Masseria, Luciano came to believe that Maranzano was even more greedy and hidebound than Masseria, declaring himself capo di tutti capi, boss of all bosses. As a consequence, Luciano arranged Maranzano's murder on September 10, 1931. Following Maranzano's death, Bonanno took over as boss, or as he called himself, father, of the majority of Maranzano's family. Bonanno, at the age of 26, became one of the youngest ever bosses of a crime family. The role of Bonanno in the events leading up to Maranzano's death has been called into question. Years later, in his autobiography, Bonanno claimed that he had no knowledge of Luciano's plans and had only learned about them from Magadino. According to Bonanno, he later discovered that Maranzano and Luciano had a feud over influence in the garment district. According to reports, the two's relationship had deteriorated to the point where Maranzano planned to murder Luciano as soon as one day after Maranzano was assassinated. The contract had been given to Irish gangster Vincent Mad Dog Call, who was on his way to Maranzano's office on the day of Maranzano's death. According to Bonanno, a war with Luciano would be futile because Luciano only wanted to be left alone to run his own rackets and demanded nothing from them. He also believed that his soldiers would not be enthused about going to the mattresses again so soon after the Castellammarese War ended. As a result, Bonanno stated that he chose the path of peace. However, mob expert Anthony Bruno says it defies mob logic to believe Luciano would have allowed Bonanno to remain alive if Bonanno had still supported Maranzano. In place of Maranzano's capo di tutti capi, Luciano established a national commission to which each family would be represented by their boss and to which each family would owe allegiance. Each family would be largely autonomous in their designated area, but the commission would resolve gang disputes. In 1931, 2 months after Maranzano was murdered, Bonanno was married to Fay Labruzzo and had 3 children. He owned 3 legitimate businesses, as well as laundries, cheese suppliers, funeral homes, and a trucking company. His funeral home in Brooklyn was suspected of being used as a front for body disposal, with double-decker coffins specially designed to fit more than one body to be buried at once. Bonanno became a citizen of the United States in 1945, and later that year, he was convicted of violating wage laws and fined $450. In November 1957, Vito Genovese convened the Appalachian Conference to discuss the future of Cosa Nostra, and Bonanno was said to have attended. The meeting, however, was called off after police investigated the destination of the many out-of-state attendees' vehicles and apprehended many of the fleeing mafiosi. Bonanno claimed he had missed the meeting, but attending Capo Gaspar Di Gregorio had Bonanno's recently renewed driver's license. An official police report, however, lists him as being caught fleeing on foot. All of those apprehended were fined up to $10,000 and sentenced to prison terms ranging from 3 to 5 years. All of the convictions, however, were overturned on appeal in 1960. In any case, Bonanno had a heart attack and was unable to testify in the trial. Allegedly, in 1963, Bonanno plotted the assassination of several Mafia Commission rivals, including bosses Tommy Lucchese, Carlo Gambino, and Stefano Magadino, as well as Frank DeSimone. He sought the support of Profaci crime family boss Joseph Magliocco, who readily agreed due to his resentment over being denied a seat on the commission previously. His audacious goal was to seize control of the commission and appoint Magliocco as his right-hand man. Magliocco delegated the assassination of Lucchese and Gambino to one of his top hit men, Joseph Colombo. The opportunistic Colombo, on the other hand, revealed the plot to its targets. Realizing Magliocco could not have planned this on his own, the other bosses concluded Bonanno was the real mastermind after remembering how close Bonanno was with Magliocco, and before him, Joe Profaci, as well as their close ties through marriages. The commission summoned Bonanno and Magliocco to give an explanation. Bonanno fled to Montreal in the middle of 1964, leaving Magliocco to deal with the commission. Magliocco, who was badly shaken and in poor health, confessed to his role in the plot. Magliocco's life was spared by the commission, but he was forced to resign as Profaci family boss and pay a $50,000 fine. Colombo took control of the Profaci family as a reward for betraying his boss. Bonanno falsely stated on his immigration documents that he had never been convicted of a crime and was held at Bordeaux prison for nearly 90 days before being forced to leave Canada. He returned to Manhattan in October 1964, but the day before Bonanno was scheduled to testify before a grand jury, his lawyers claimed that after dinner with them, Bonanno was kidnapped, allegedly by Magadino's men, as he entered the apartment house where one of his lawyers lived on Park Avenue and East 36th Street. FBI recordings of New Jersey boss Sam the Plumber DeCavalcante revealed that when Bonanno disappeared, the other bosses were taken aback, and other FBI recordings captured angry Bonanno soldiers saying, "That son of a bee took off and left us here alone." During Bonanno's 2-year absence, Gaspar Di Gregorio used family discontent over the role of Bonanno's son, Salvatore Bill Bonanno, to claim family leadership. The Mafia Commission named Di Gregorio as Bonanno family boss, and the Di Gregorio revolt sparked into a 4-year conflict in the Bonanno family, dubbed the Bonanno War by the media. This caused a schism in the family between Bill supporters and Di Gregorio supporters. Di Gregorio allegedly contacted Bill about holding a peace meeting in early 1966. Bill agreed and suggested meeting at his grandfather's house on Troutman Street in Brooklyn. As Bill and his loyalists approached the house on January 28, 1966, they were met with gunfire. No one, however, was injured during this confrontation. On May 17, 1966, Bonanno reappeared at Foley Square, and in 1968 Di Gregorio was wounded by machine gun fire and later suffered a heart attack. The commission eventually became dissatisfied with Di Gregorio's efforts to quell the family rebellion and switched their support to Paul Sciacca. After a heart attack in 1968, Bonanno agreed to retire as boss and relocate to Arizona, putting an end to the family feud. As part of the peace agreement, Bill resigned as consigliere and moved out of New York with his father. Bonanno had become interested in writing an autobiography to offer his own take on his life. His book was published in 1983 as A Man of Honor, the autobiography of Joseph Bonanno. He justified his decision to write A Man of Honor by claiming that Omerta represented a lifestyle and tradition greater than or beyond the code of silence it is commonly understood to be, as he had not been compelled to reveal his secrets by becoming an informant or government witness. Joseph Bonanno and his son Bill appeared on CBS News TV's 60 Minutes in April 1983 to be interviewed by correspondent Mike Wallace. Later, in 1983, he was imprisoned for 8 months for obstructing justice, and in 1985, he was imprisoned for 14 months for contempt of court for refusing to testify in a federal racketeering case. He was transferred from Tucson Federal Correctional Institution to the U.S. Medical Center for Federal Prisoners in Springfield, Missouri, due to ill health at his advanced age, and was released on November 1, 1986. Bonanno died on May 11, 2002, of heart failure at the age of 97, and is buried at Holy Hope Cemetery and Mausoleum in Tucson.